JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFT's daily market review for April the 30th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFT, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar continued trading lower against most of the other G10 currencies on Wednesday and during the Asian morning Thursday. It gained slightly only versus the Swiss franc and the British pound, while it was found virtually unchanged against the Japanese yen. The main gainers were NZD, NOK, CAD, Aussie, and Aussie in that order. The strengthening of the commodity-linked currencies and the relative weakness of the safe havens suggest that investors' morale continued to be supported. Indeed, turning our gaze to the equity world, we see that major EU and US indices were a sea of green, with a positive sentiment rolling into the Asian session today. Japan's Nikkei 225 and China's Shanghai Composite gained 2.14% and 1.31% respectively. What added to the optimism may have been reports that the antiviral drug developed by Gilead Sciences Inc. proved effective in helping people infected by the coronavirus to recover more quickly. A dovish Fed may have also helped market sentiment. The committee kept interest rates unchanged at the 0.025% range and hinted that more stimulus may be delivered if judged necessary. We will continue to use powers proactively until we are confident that the US is solidly on the road to recovery, Fed Chair Powell noted. He also added that economic activity will likely drop at an unprecedented pace in the second quarter, which suggests that they are more likely to act again than not. Remember, in the past, we noted that monetary and fiscal stimulus may not be enough to support a long-lasting recovery in the broader market sentiment. Back then, we noted that a vaccine was needed to make us more confident on that front. Now, the combination of stimulative measures and the prospect of a vaccine being ready for distribution soon make us more trustful over further recovery in equities and risk-linked assets. With that in mind, we would expect the dollar and other safe havens like bonds and the yen to stay on the back foot. That said, there are still risks to that view. If governments around the globe lift the stay-at-home measures too quickly, the coronavirus may start spreading at an exponential pace again, which will take us back to square one. Now, as for today, the central bank torch will be passed to the ECB. Last Thursday, preliminary data revealed that the euro area manufacturing PMI fell to 33.6 from 44.5, hitting its lowest since February 2009, while the services index fell to 11.7, its lowest ever, dragging the composite PMI down to 13.5 from 29.7. Despite recent signs that the pandemic may be leveling off, this data suggests that the Eurozone's economic outlook continued to deteriorate at the beginning of the second quarter. And it remains to be seen whether this, combined with a potential slowdown in inflation ahead of the decision, will prompt the ECB to expand even further its stimulus efforts. Just for the record, a couple of weeks ago, President Christine Lagarde said that she and her colleagues are committed to doing everything within their mandate to fight the crisis. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the European Day, Eurozone's preliminary CPIs for April and the bloc's first estimate of GDP for the first quarter are due to be released just a few hours before the ECB decision. Both the headline and core CPI rates are expected to have tumbled to 0.1 and 0.7% year over year from 0.7 and 1% respectively, while the GDP data are anticipated to show that the euro area economy has shrunk 3.2% quarter over quarter after expanding only 0.1% in the last 3 months of 2019. Taking into account the fast spreading of the coronavirus in Europe during the last month of the quarter, a contracting economy is nothing but a given for the financial community. Therefore, we believe that euro traders may focus more on the ECB's response to the damages caused by the pandemic rather than the data itself. From the US, we get the initial jobless claims for last week, and the forecast points to another 3.5 million increase following the 4.43 million surge the week before. Personal income and spending for March, alongside the year-over-year core PCE rate for the month, are also due to be released. Both income and spending are forecast to have fallen 1.5% month over month and 5% month over month after rising 0.6 and 0.2% respectively, while the core PCE rate is anticipated to have slid to 1.6% year over year from 1.8%. From Canada, we have the monthly GDP for February, with the forecast suggesting a 0.1% month over month growth, the same as in January. As for tonight, during the Asian morning Friday, Japan's Tokyo CPIs are due to be released, with the core rate expected to have slid to 0.1% year over year from 0.4%. No forecast is available for the headline rate. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. At this point, I need to let you know that there will be no daily market review tomorrow. So goodbye, have a great day, a greater weekend, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next week.
JFT, just fair and direct.